time.
What's true in the light is true in the darkness. Though sorrow is real, you won't let it break us. So we sing in the night and trust in your promises. You're true in the light and true in the darkness. Now more than ever, keep me tethered. The pain I feel has come to steal the truth that's been my anchor. Wild winds are shaking my foundations. Give me strength to stand against these doubts as they come flooding. To put my hope in what I know instead of what I'm feeling. What's true in the light is true in the darkness. The sorrow is real, you won't let it break us. So we see in the night and trust in your promise. But they're not gospel. My troubled mind is sinking sand, but you are ever faithful. Unshakable, unbreakable. Your love will keep me stable. What's true in the light is true in the darkness. The sorrow is real, you won't let it break us. So we see in the night. Trust in your promises. You're true in the light and true in the darkness. You're my true north, you're my compass. Holy Spirit, come and lead us. Be my rock, Lord, in my weakness.
All right. Hey, good morning, everybody. It is Monday morning, April the 24th, 2023. Let me say good morning to everybody. It's a beautiful Monday. And good morning to Kelly Kenfield, to Kelly and Melody Woods, to Kathleen. Good morning to Jeannie and to Eileen. Continuing to pray for your for Patty, who now has pneumonia. So we need to be lifting up Patty. Please lift up Patty in prayer. She has pneumonia and her asthma is severe. She's still at the hospital. So Lord, we right now, Lord, in Yeshua's name, we lift up Patty to you. Lord, we ask that by your power, by your strength, that you would breathe the breath of your life into her lungs, Lord, that you would breathe newness into her, Lord, that she would breathe deep by the power of your spirit in Yeshua's name. Amen. Amen. Good morning to Joshua, to Ron and Amy, to Jerry and Janet, to Dayspring, to Rachel, Hattie, to Charlene, and good morning to the Eddies, to Lauren and Mike and David and Levi and Valor and Haven and Everett, and to Barbara Callahan, Pastor and Sister Martinez. Good morning to Tina and Joyce and Joe, and good morning to my sister Maria. I love you, sis. Hope you're doing well. And to Elizabeth and to Jesse And to Sonia and Margarita, Sonia Tkach, good morning to everyone. All right, well, hope you had a great weekend, and we're going to continue in Isaiah. I number our daily mannas, so this is our 115th daily manna in Isaiah so far.
Is that really?
Yeah, 115. Yeah, so we're plodding through slowly, and there's a lot there, so hopefully we're imbibing as much as we're able to. I've entitled today's daily manna, Seeing Through the Eyes of Eternity. Seeing Through the Eyes of Eternity. Let's just kind of back up, get a running start, beginning in verse 4 of chapter 50. Hang on, I need a drink. Adonai Elohim has given me, or Sovereign Lord has given me, the tongue of the learned, of a disciple, and of the teacher, that I may know how to sustain the weary with a word. He awakens me morning by morning. He awakens my ear to give heed as a disciple. The Sovereign Lord, Adonai Elohim, has opened my ear, and I was not rebellious, nor did I turn back. I gave my back to those who strike, and my cheeks to those pulling out my beard. I did not hide my face from humiliation and spitting. For Adonai Elohim, the Sovereign Lord, is with me, or will help me, excuse me. Therefore, I have not been disgraced. Therefore, I set my face like flint, and I know that I will not be ashamed, right? And so, again, we mentioned on Friday, which we went much more into this passage on Friday, that, in the ancient Near East, one who would have submitted meekly to public humiliation was at least tacitly admitting to having done something to deserve the abuse. But this person, this one, after having submitted and had in obedience to what he's receiving daily, you know, he's listening to the Lord, day by day, getting instruction and not rejecting it, not rebelling against it. And so having submitted to it, he says, and I know that I've not done anything wrong, that I will be vindicated, he continues to say in verse 8. The one who vindicates me is near. Who will accuse me? Let us stand up to each other. Who is my adversary? Let him confront me. So Adonai Elohim, the Sovereign Lord, says, see, behold, he will help me. Who is he who would condemn me? It says, behold, look, they all wear out like a garment. A moth will eat them up. And then we close with these two verses, and this is, we'll kind of flow into, we closed Friday with these two verses, which flow into today's. Who among you fears Adonai? Who listens? Who shemas? Or it doesn't say who, it says, who among you fears Adonai? Hearing, shemaing, the obeying, heeding the voice of his servant. So now we recognize this is the servant. Verses 4 through 9 had been the voice of the servant. Who, in fearing the Lord, do you heed the voice of the servant? It says, which walks in darkness and has no light, let him trust in the name of Adonai and lean upon his God. Verse 11, behold, all you who kindle a fire, encircling yourselves with firebrands, walking in the light of your fire, and among the brands you have lit, this you will have from my hand. You will lie down in torment, or from pain, atzav, which is the with pain and toil, right? And so there are two options these last two verses give us of how we're going to walk. There's going to be one who listens, who fears the Lord, who listens to the voice of his servant, but he may at that moment feel like he's walking in darkness. And so what the instruction is, for the one who listens to the voice of the servant, right, it's like it may seem dark, no light. So when you're walking in the dark, you're walking in no light, you're fully and totally dependent upon his voice, listening for where he's telling you to go, leaning on him, leaning against him, trusting in him, right? So like a blind person holding on to someone, fully depending. But the one who walks in the light of his own, in self-reliance, who lights his own light and depends upon his own light, he's gonna lay down in pain. So the chapter 51 now turns full attention to the first one. Okay, so for you who are gonna walk, who are gonna fear the Lord, for you, those who are going to lean on Him, who are gonna trust in Him, even through the darkness, this becomes chapter 51 becomes this word of comfort, because it opens up. It says, "Shema, listen to me, you who fear," or excuse me, "you who pursue righteousness," is the language here. It's tzedek, who pursue righteousness. "You who seek Adonai," and the word for seek has to do with asking and requesting, and it's the word that is used in Hebrew to say please, bavakasha, who are bavakashaing the Lord, please, right? So those who are in pursuit of righteousness, the one who's in pursuit of righteousness, seeking the Lord, he may find himself discouraged, because when you look around the world and you're in pursuit of righteousness and you're seeking the Lord and asking the Lord, and it doesn't feel like the Lord is responding as quickly as you want to, as you thought he would, you can find yourself in a place of discouragement, whether there's people in exile or waiting on the deliverance, the salvation of the Lord. You know, there are those around, back in Isaiah 46:12, talked about those who are around who are hard-hearted and said, look, the Lord's salvation is near. But those who are hard-hearted, they're not really troubled by what we perceive as what feels like the Lord's slowness in keeping his promises, right? Because they've not really trusted him or looked to him anyway. So they're like, they've kind of discounted what the Lord is doing. But for those who do trust the word of the Lord, those who are in pursuit of his righteousness, those who are bavakashaing, Lord, please, please. You know, the long wait can be discouraging and challenging. And so to them here, the Lord offers words of comfort and consolation. He says, listen, you who are hunting after, pursuing righteousness, you who are asking of the Lord, he goes, I want you to, and he begins to point backward, right, to the former things, to the first things, right? And again, not because those specific things are the way, are exactly what's going to happen again, but because his character is faithful, to look back at his faithfulness through the long wait, right? To look back at how he's always been faithful and how there have been times where it looks long, but we are, so for instance, he begins to point back to Abraham, we'll look in a minute. Now you and I can see, and the people of Isaiah's time, the people following Isaiah, can look back to the story of Abraham, and they can see the call of Abraham in Genesis 12, and they can see, you know, the whole struggle, and to where finally a baby is born, and, you know, 25 years later, they can look at the whole of that and see how faithful God was, because they've got that whole picture to look back at. But if you're in the middle of the story, if you're 10 years into the 25 years waiting for the promise of God, you can begin to struggle. And so we can draw faith by looking at those who've gone before us, because we can look at the whole story and what seems like a long thing, but now we can see how faithful God was. And from that, we can extrapolate that he's still faithful, and that the long wait for us, he will faithfully come through. Listen to me, you who pursue, who are in pursuit of righteousness, you who seek Adonai. It says, look to the rock from which you were hewn and to the quarry from which you were dug. So listen, I want you to hear and heed. And then he tells us to look. I've titled today's Manna, See with Eyes, Seeing with the Eyes of Eternity. I believe I titled it that, right? Seeing through the eyes of eternity. Because the word for look here, a lot of times when we'll be told to see, it's a word that's connected with your eyes. But this word for look is a word, nabat. That's the root word, nabat, which is to look upon something not through the physical, but to behold it almost with an eternal perspective or with a spiritual perspective, to look with hope, to look and to behold something and to see it for what it really is, to behold it as an act of grace. And so if you look just with your physical eyes, you might not see, right? With your physical eyes, you look right at the circumstances, it may look bleak, it may look dark. But nabat, look, behold, right? So you're not just looking with physical eyes, you're looking with spiritual eyes. It's the same language the Lord used when he spoke to Abraham in Genesis 15. Verse 5, he says, he took him outside and he said, look up now. And he uses the language, he says, look now. Nabat, look now at the sky, right? So he's not just saying, I want you to look at the sky. Yeah, sure. But I want you to see what I'm saying. He says, look at the sky and count the stars if you're able to count them. And then he said to him, so shall your seed be. Right? When does he tell him this? He tells him this in Genesis 15. When the Genesis 15 opens up, and the Lord speaks to him and says, I'm your very great reward. And Abraham says, okay, I'm just trying to understand. This is probably 10 years later from Genesis chapter 12. I'm trying to understand, maybe this is going to come through, is the promise through my servant Eliezer? How can this be since I don't have a son? I don't have a child, right? And so the Lord, you know, he's trying to figure out. He's trusting the Lord, but he's saying, maybe I didn't get it right. Maybe I didn't understand it. Maybe there was something you meant differently. And the Lord says, no, he'll come from you. And, of course, we know that they continue to struggle because it's not happening. And then rather than waiting on the promises of God, they try to take it into their own hands. And the whole thing with Ishmael and Hagar, you know, that all happens. So the Lord points back here. And he says, look, I want you to look at this. Look at the rock from which you were hewn, the cistern from which you were dug out or hammered out, right? And usually rock, when the scriptures, rock refers to God. And on some level, that could, the meaning is possible here. He could be pointing to overall, I am the rock from which we were hewn. But this verse, and specifically we'll see in verse 2, points us to Abraham and Sarah. So Abraham and Sarah, in one sense, are the rock and the quarry, although it could be that the Lord is the rock and Abraham and Sarah are the quarry. But either way, there's a parallelism. He's saying, look backward. He said, I want you to draw from what I've done, draw from their story. Right? This is sort of an early version of Hebrews 11, of faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So when you don't see it, when you don't look back, I want you to look back at others who held on waiting. And in their lifetime, you know, they knew there was a better city. They were waiting for that which was yet to come. And this is sort of an early version of that, of the Lord saying, draw from that understanding as you pursue righteousness, as you seek the Lord, right? As you wait and you hope for your deliverance. I want you to look, behold through the eyes of eternity. Look with eyes of faith. Look to your origins. Look to the rock from which you were hewn. Verse 2 says, uses the word again, behold, look. Look upon your father Abraham and to Sarah who bore you. For when I called him, he was but one. Then I blessed him and multiplied him. He says, I want you to look. I want you to nabat with spiritual eyes upon your father Abraham. Right? The Lord gave him the promise, and he believed. And I don't want you to just look upon Abraham, because Sarah was part of this. Look at Sarah, because, right, she was the barren one, and she was the one that, through whom the promise seemed impossible. And it says, because Echad, they were one when I called them, like, they were just this unit, this one, this, there's just one when I called. And again, you know, in Hebrews 11 talks about this as far as childbearing was concerned. they were both as good as they were as good as dead. There's by the time you know Isaac is born, 190 years. He's 100. She's 90. You know, she laughed. Come on. And so perhaps the illustration of the rock from which you were hewn, this sort of inanimate object, is appropriate as well. From the unpromising beginning, the Lord produced, he fulfilled his promise. In the, like, if you go into the midst of the struggle of Abraham and Sarah. Okay, let's keep recording. You go into the struggle of Abraham and Sarah. I'm so frustrated that we dropped the stream. We're gonna upload it. Okay. But we can look back at it. We come into their struggle and we can look back and see that God came through. Back in Genesis 17. The Lord said, for my part, verse 4, because my covenant is with you, your father, you will be the father of a multitude of nations. No longer will your name be Avram, but your name will be Abraham, because I make you the father of a multitude of nations. Yes, I will make you exceedingly fruitful, and I will make you into nations, and kings will come forth from you. Right? So the Lord took them, and he took the one and blessed. He says, I blessed him and multiplied him. He says, draw upon that. I want you to look with eyes of faith, look with eyes of eternity upon your origins. It looked bleak. It looked hopeless. And look at what became a multitude. And because in their humanity, you can see where Abraham and Sarah, even as faithful ones in their humanity, how they struggled, but God was faithful. So you may have your moments of struggle, so hold on. The Lord says, I want you to look now, look through with eyes of faith upon your history, right? That's the source of comfort to enable you to endure that the Lord is faithful with his promises. Verse 3, are you going to, is it going to potentially go back up live right now? Okay. All right. For Adonai will comfort Zion. He will console Zion. He will console or comfort all her desolate places, her waste places. And he will make or he will establish, appoint her wilderness like Eden, her desert like the garden of Adonai. Joy and gladness will be found in her, and thanksgiving and a sound of melody. Right? So here, it's basically saying the Lord is determined to comfort. The verb tense is he's going to comfort. He's going to look with compassion. He's going to establish this. Based on the analogy he points to with Abraham and Sarah, that's what from the small, there's multiplication. He's going to do that in you, right? So that the hopelessness of Abraham and Sarah matches the ruins of Zion. And the same action that blessed Abraham and Sarah will make Zion's new future. The one who became the many will be matched by the ruins of Zion, which will become like a garden of Eden. And again, Eden is not simply a figure of luxury, although the word means luxuriant. It's not a figure of just beauty and plenty, but it's saying this is a reversal of the curse, that the Lord is making all things new, that this is ultimately what he's going to do. He's going to take the rubble, he's going to take the ruins, and he's going to make the garden of the Lord. And where there's pain, the rubble, the ruins that have been marked with pain will be marked with joy and rejoicing. The land that has produced, that he made to be a source of fruitfulness that became a source of thorns and thistles, will now become a place of joy and rejoicing. And then going into verse 4, now the Lord becomes even more personal with his people, right? There's more intimacy here. You know, in verse 1, he says, to those, listen, hear, Shema, those pursuing righteousness, those calling upon the Lord, those that are asking for the Lord. But now he speaks to them, he says, pay attention, my people, my nation, right? You're mine. I've redeemed you. I've called you by name. You are mine. He says, pay attention, my people, to me, my people. Give ear to me. Turn your ear to me, my nation. Right? This language for my nation, where it's singular, it's not using the word goy. It's using a word that has to do with the peoples, and it speaks to nations. But here it's singular, but my people, where he says my people in two different ways. Why? Listen, why? Why pay close attention? Well, because here's what I want you to know, he says. It says, ki Torah, for the instruction, for the Torah will go out from me. My justice, my mishpat, as a light to the peoples. So it's not a question about God's ability and willingness to save his own people from their sin. What he's about to do, he says, draw near, will be the means by which his instructions that they've will go forth to the world, that his justice will be a light to the world. Just as was stated in back early in Isaiah chapter 2, verses 2 and 3. Isaiah 2:2. It will come to pass in the last days that the mountain of Adonai's house will stand firm as the head of the mountains and will be exalted above the hills. So all nations will flow to it. Then many peoples will go and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of Adonai, to the house of the God of Jacob. Then he will teach us his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For Torah will go forth from Zion, and the word of Adonai from Jerusalem. Right? So because of what God will do for the children of Abraham, all the world will come into his light to experience his just rule. The word mishpat, it's simply more than just justice or judgment. Right, it's the fair, equitable, it's the right governance, the governing of the world by its creator in the way that he intended it to be. Right, so that the opposite of justice, in one sense, mishpat, is not injustice. It includes injustice, but the opposite is more likely to be it's chaos. His justice, where all is working correctly. Right, and that. Which is a light to the peoples, is including all the right. That's what's going to go forth. The Lord's instructions, the Lord's justice will go forth. And it says, and it will, the language you can't see here in the translation, where it says, my justice as a light to the peoples. But it says, my justice as a light to the peoples, it will rest. Like, my justice will rest upon, lay down, rest upon, cover over them like a light that covers over the peoples. It will rest upon them. And this is the language. This is what so earlier, right, in Isaiah 42, this is what the prophet said the servant would do. Isaiah 42:1, behold my servant whom I uphold, my chosen one in whom my soul delights. I have put my ruach on him. He will bring justice to the nations. Verse 4, he will not be disheartened or crushed until he establishes justice on earth. The islands will wait for his Torah, for his instruction, right? Isaiah 49:6. So he says, it is too trifling of a thing, he says, that you should be my servant to raise up the tribes of Jacob and restore the preserved ones of Israel. So I will give you as a light for the nations, that you should be my salvation to the end of the earth. And prior to that, early in Isaiah 9:6, speaking of what the one unto us a child is born, what he would do, it says, of the increase of his government and of his shalom, there will be no end. And on the throne of David and over his kingdom, this is Isaiah 9:6, to establish it and uphold it through justice and righteousness from now until forevermore. The zeal of Adonai Tzevaot will accomplish this. So the Lord says, my servant will do this. My servant will do this. The Messiah, the one that's born in Isaiah 9:6, this is going to do this. And now here in 51, he's basically saying, I'm going to do this, right? Which tells us something about the identity of this, of the servant, of the Messiah. Just pay attention, my people. Give ear to me, my nation. Again, verse 4. Because here's what's happening. For instruction will go out from me, my justice as a light to the peoples. Verse 5. My righteousness is near. My salvation, my yesha, has gone forth, has gone out. And my arms will judge, will bring justice, will bring shafat mishpat, will bring right justice to the nations. My arm or my arms. The coastlands will wait for me. For my arm, they will wait expectantly, they will endure. So he says, my righteousness is near, right? My righteousness is close. My salvation has gone forth, and my arm will bring justice, right? When the scripture speaks of right, it says my righteousness is near. When the scripture speaks of righteousness, when it speaks of righteousness for humanity, right? It's speaking of us conforming to what is right, to the character of God, to the claims of God, to the commands of God, because it's pointing. But when it speaks of Him, the righteousness of God, it's pointing to the quality of everything that He does. Everything that He does is right. Everything that He does flows forth from that. It is right and whole and just and pure. And so out from who He is flows what He does. And see, He is His salvation that has gone forth from who He is. His righteousness is near. My salvation has gone forth. And it will be accomplished. My justice, my arms will bring justice. And so here, verse 5, again, makes it plain that deliverance that's being talked about is more than simply deliverance from Babylon, because it says the nations, the coastlands will wait. Why would the ends of the earth, why will the islands wait for that deliverance for them to be delivered from Babylon? Right? Why should they hope for that? But if God's going to use His servant to deliver the world from the clutches of sin, just like Cyrus was going to deliver the Israelites from the clutches, He's going to deliver Judah from the clutches of Babylon. Well, that is a salvation, right? That has implications for the whole world, and His arm will accomplish it. Isaiah uses the plural here, and there's a fullness that's expressed here. And we begin to see more and more where the Lord's talking about His arm, His zeruah, which will accomplish His salvation for Him. Says for my arm they will wait expectantly. They're going to endure. Verse 6. He says, lift up your eyes to the heavens. Look up to the heavens. Lift up to your eyes to the heavens. And then it says, and look at the earth beneath. And again, it uses that language, Nabat, to look at the earth beneath. Look at what you're standing on. And it uses the language Nabat. Look with eyes, the eyes of eternity. Look at what you're standing on. Boy, that seems stable. This seems real. This seems like the real deal. So I want you to lift up your eyes. Look at what you can't reach, right? But you can see it. And look and behold with spiritual eyes the thing you're standing on. He says, because here's why I want you to look at that. Because the heavens will vanish like smoke. That's going to all dissipate, break into pieces like smoke. Whew. And the earth, that which you're standing on, it's going to, like a garment, it's going to wear out. And look around, its inhabitants, says, they'll die like gnats or like mosquitoes. Like everything, what are they saying? All the things that, what's coming against you that feels like this is all terrible or horrible, that's going to all be gone. That's going to be gone. That's going to be gone. But my salvation, my Yeshua, for the ages, for eternity, it will be. It will be forever. And my righteousness will not be destroyed. All right, so fix your eyes upon me. My righteousness is near. My salvation has gone forth. So hang on. I'm going to bring comfort, he says. Again, verse 7, now he comes to and he says, Shema, listen to me. You who know justice. Right? And he uses again the word righteousness here. You who know righteousness. Listen to me, you who recognize, who know what righteousness is. Who knows righteousness? He follows up there with a parallel. A people with my instructions, with my Torah in their hearts. Right, so you understand his righteousness in greater measure because He's written it upon your heart. His law has been written on your heart. So he says, listen to me, hear me now. That this you've internalized this reality. It's not simply something you're going through the motions of. It says, do not fear the taunt or the reproach, the insults of, it uses the word men here, but it uses the word enosh, right, which is mortals. People that are dying, frail men, like mosquitoes. Don't be afraid. You who have internalized my righteousness, you who know my righteousness and my instructions have taken root in your heart. Don't fear the reproach, the taunt, the insults of mortals. It says, don't be dismayed. Don't be shattered. Don't be falling apart at their insults or their blasphemies. Because verse 8, for like a garment is eaten by a moth, and like a wool is eaten by a worm, they will be. There's an expiration date on all that. Don't fear what is temporary. You who fear the Lord, even when you're walking through the darkness, lean on him, depend on him, listen to the voice of his servant. He goes, because my righteousness will be forever, and my salvation for all generations, or for generation of generations, right? For generation and generations. So this is this early call to, and a word of consolation, a word of comfort. It's very similar to, has a relationship to what we see rolling out of Hebrews chapter 10 into Hebrews 11. It says, look, we're not the ones who are crumbling and falling apart ones. We are the righteous will live by trust, even when I can't understand, even when I can't see it, even when it feels like I'm walking in the dark. My option isn't to light my own fire and figure it all out. My option is to wait on him, to trust in him, to internalize his word, to let his word take root in my life, to remember how faithful he's been, to draw upon, remember those who have gone before us, the rock from which you were hewn. Remember that. Bring it to mind so that you can be built upon in your faith upon the Lord's faithfulness. That look with eyes, look at the earth below you with eyes of faith to recognize it's going to fall apart. But his salvation, his righteousness is forever. Lord, fix our eyes on you. Help us to see with spiritual eyes. Help us, Lord, not to be overwhelmed by what we can't understand, by what seems like the darkness in front of us and all around us. But may we lean upon you. May we trust in you and look to you. In Yeshua's name, amen. All right. Well, I know that we dropped, and I don't think we came back.
We did come back.
We did?
A couple of people came on
here. Okay. All right. Well, I'm glad that you guys were able to join back in, and then we're going to go ahead and get this uploaded so that the whole thing is one on let me look here and see who's. Did anybody else join us after the fact? No, I see.
No.
Okay, so we'll get it all uploaded so that it's one piece. All right. Well, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Shalom, shalom. Have a beautiful day.
What's true in the light is true in the darkness. Though sorrow is real, you won't let it break us. So we sing in the night and trust in your promises. You're true in the light and true in the darkness. Now more than ever, keep me tethered. The pain I feel has come to steal the truth that's been my anchor. Wild winds are shaking my foundations. Give me strength to stand against these doubts as they come flooding. To put my hope in what I know instead of what I'm feeling.
beautiful, but they're not gospel. My troubled mind is sinking sand, but you are ever faithful, unshakable, unbreakable. Your love will keep me stable. What's true in the light is true in the darkness. Though sorrow is real, you won't let it break us. So we see in the night and trust in your promise. You're my true.